I am Tom and I have now basically three problems. The first problem is I don't know how familiar you are with build systems, and the average C++ developer don't know the vocabulary regarding to the implementation of build systems. The second big problem is that the field of build systems is huge. So there are so many build systems out there, and it is very hard to discuss some of them in 60 minutes and give an introduction into build systems. Therefore, I will keep on the overview. And the third problem is the discussion of build system is very controversial. So there will be much discussions about them, and I'm really happy to discuss them in a hot discussion after the talk with you in person. So, at first, normally in talks, I want to know something about my audience that I can go to the needs of the audience. Who of you is currently using CMake? Great, the normal picture. More specifically, who is using CMake together with Make, the traditional choice? I would say 60% maybe. Who is using it with Ninja? Great, the others. And who is using it with something else? For example?
Please?
Bob. Bob. Yeah, I actually never heard it. Doesn't matter. Maybe we can talk afterwards. Some guys create their Visual Studio projects out of it. Is another possibility. Who of you is more modern? Who is involved in a in a Griffy project? Who is using Bazel or Buck? Oh, at least a few. There are some Bazel guys behind there, I think. Okay. Build systems are hard. And build systems can be quite religious. So this is very hard to discuss between two people who found their build systems to discuss an objective average between them. I personally have a strong background in Java, so Matthias' talk was quite familiar with me with the whole Xtext stuff. It's Java pure. But in Java, we don't have this much discussions because everybody is just using Maven or Gradle. Therefore, there's much reuse of code, and the sharing of libraries is quite easy. But last year or 2 years ago, I moved to embedded programming, and I think you expect Java isn't the best language for embedded programming. Therefore, it was my job in our company to evaluate the landscape of build systems in C++, and therefore I gathered some colleagues, gathered some beer, and we sat together one evening to evaluate the build systems. We had an idea. After 10 minutes, our first approach to view all of them missed, and we had to come up with a better strategy. Okay, these are all slides. This talk is structured into three main parts. In the first part, I will cover the basics. The basics are necessary to understand the concepts behind build systems. As soon as we get the concepts, we are able to create a metric how we can judge which build system is suitable for our project, because not every build system is suitable for every kind of project, so you have to decide depending on your own requirements. The concepts are necessary to create this metric, and I will show you an example metric that worked for us, but I expect of you that you use your own minds and rethink the metric I created, and maybe you come up with an own metric where you can compare them by yourself. The last part of the talk, I do the actual comparing like I did in my company, and you can follow my comparison and compare them for your own in your own company then. And I have actually the wrong slides, therefore I have to switch them now, because otherwise it becomes a mess pretty soon, because actually these are the slides. And you just look away, look away, look away, come on, guys, it's boring otherwise. Okay, this was my, okay, we had this already. You don't have to take pictures of my metrics, because after the talk you can just go to this link. I will post it in a meetup group afterwards, and I will publish my resources I used for research, as well as the link to my slides. There you can download them, can download my metric, can download my judgment and do it your own. This is the most important thing. So, who I am that I can talk about build systems? My name is Tom, simply Tom, and I have a big love to programming technologies and programming languages. I'm the kind of guy who is creating own programming languages and reading language specs. I already read the Java language specs, the JVM specs, and currently I'm reading the C++ spec, but it's quite a hard job to read this. On my daytime, I'm involved in developing autonomous drones and do some embedded programming there, as I mentioned before. But I have a strong background in Java. We already heard some critics on Java, and it's quite normal on a C++ meetup to critic Java, and on Java meetup to critic all C++, and I'm really not a big fan of it. In my view, it is really pointless, all this religion about these languages, tools, and so on. They are just a vehicle for us to drive our ideas. On the other hand, I'm not a fan neither, for just hypes, just following of hypes. So just use your own minds, accept other languages, other tools, and so on, and use your mind and come up with own ideas as well. I'm also a regular speaker on meetups, and also I'm an organizer of two meetups in Kempten in the Allgäu. So I traveled a little bit to come here. It's quite an honor for me to speak here today, because I really like the C++ meetup. So, to get you awake, who of you is a developer? Some are not? You? Okay, what are you doing? Great. Even if you are not a developer, but you are a manager or somebody, the first half of the talk should stay quite interesting. You can go afterwards. I maybe can give a sign. So I see basically two reasons as your developer, why are you here? The first reason is, of course, you are just interested in build systems. The second reason is you are here for the good food. We had great pizza outside, I think. I think your interest in build systems is not representative. You are guys who go to meetups and are interested in new technologies, and so there is a big interest and a big reasoning in build systems of you guys. But in my opinion, the average C++ programmer, or the average programmer as is, has too less interest in build systems, and especially treat the code for the build system as secondary concern. Therefore, you often see that the build description files have a very bad code quality, where you do refactoring over refactoring over refactoring in your normal C++ code. But I really like it that you are here to learn something. So, we want basically build system to compile files. When we start a project, we have to start with the first file. We have to start with the first five files. The intuitive way is to just use GCC and specify an output directory for the executable. This is a very naive approach, and after the first day, you are quite happy that you have an executable that you can ship to your customer, and you have this DevOps mindset where you can ship every day. But on the next day, you have to come in and have to basically type the same command again. Therefore, you at 8 o'clock in the next morning, you type it again, and now push it in a build script that you make executable, and now you can check it in your version control system. So your colleague can use it as well. He immediately comes to you and says, "Hey, I want to use Clang. So please, can you modify it?" Sure, we can. We just use the environment variable. This environment variable is normally configured in a way that it points to Clang on his system, on GCC on my system. So we are really conformed to the open-close principle. We are open for extension. We can add new compilers. But closed for modification, we don't have to touch the script anymore. Does anybody spot some problems with this approach so far? Because this is an automated build system. We just have to execute one script. There are some problems with this approach. Any idea? Yes?
I have my big project like 500 files, and I'm combining them all one after the other, and it's going to be really slow.
Slow, and it doesn't scale, for example. Yes? Yes? Yes, you are tied to the bash syntax. You are tied to a syntax in every case, but maybe bash is not the best because it's a general purpose language, maybe. and you are very platform specific. Do you want to say something? Yes, you have to do the whole job every time. So our fictional development team goes out to Stack Overflow and detects this great tool for C++ Make. So we just convert our bash script in a very, very simple make file and execute it again. It works just the same. Now we are platform independent. It is faster because we could it on multiple cores, maybe. Yes, we just have make. It's a common build system. So, who of you is using just make without a meta over it on a daily basis? Oh, we have two diehards here. Respect, guys, respect. because this one isn't that good. We can spot two obvious errors in this approach. We have to list every file twice, once for the dependencies, once for the actual compilation. The second one is that we still have to recompile everything in every step, even if we didn't touch the add.cpp, for example. So we go out to Stack Overflow again and come up with this minimal make file. This does basically everything. It creates some dependency files and links stuff together. I just typed this from a book and I wasn't able to bring it to compile because you get this error every time because in make you have to use tabs, not spaces. You immediately recognize that Make is not a new language. Actually, Make was created 1976. Does anybody know when C++ was invented? Some history? 79, 3 years after Make. Make is traditionally a C build system. Great. But as soon as we have compiled this make file successfully, we can execute it and have every characteristics that we want from our automated build system because we do work only once. For example, if we execute make just two times in a row, it does nothing the second time because it don't have to. Now you can ask, why is make so difficult to type and why does nearly nobody do it directly? You have to understand the guys at Bell Labs who created make, I think, had the attitude that they want to spread harm in the world. They started with a very simple approach to compile C code. And then the first requirement comes and the second requirement, and they just added it to a language. Because building software is a very complex task. We will see it in a moment. Great. We experience the same with our own build system. For example, in our fictional department, in our fictional programming department, we just take the makefile from before and give it to our developers. They are quite happy because it's fast and it works everything. And this goes a few weeks, the developers just adding their dependencies on this first, their files on this first lines, and maybe 200 or 300, some Utopia amounts of files are added in this time. And then the trouble begins. Your build is, your build times go up. So you just give your makefile a better look, and you see in your logs some files are compiled twice, some files aren't recompiled in a good way, and therefore it causes failing builds. Your developers immediately recognize that a make clean helped, and so this this culture of this make clean, the culture of clean build, evolved in your company. Had anybody the experience of this clean build culture in this company? We had just type clean build. Okay, I didn't expect so much. I had the same. Whenever you do a clean build, you just say no reuse. The compile times aren't a thing for me. Therefore, whenever you have this culture of a clean build, your automatic build system fails. So, actually, because of this problem of the long build times and the clean build culture you detected in a company, you send somebody out to a make workshop, and he creates a meta framework over make, and he comes back with this own written framework. You just write your sources up here, specify your output, your libraries, and your frameworks you want to include. This looks very clean and nice, and nothing to compared to make. So you have created your own little build systems. This works very well, and everybody is happy for now. But then the first requirement comes. Hey, I want this this compiler flag. The other says, hey, I want linking this in this way. And the third comes and says, hey, on Windows, I want to link them two libraries together and not the third. And therefore, your build system grows and grows and grows, and basically after a few months or years, your build system is as complex as make was in the beginning, so you gained nothing. This is because build systems are just hard. So, I have the question, why are you here? Ask in the beginning. It doesn't matter for me if you are interested or not, because I have, because you are already here in my talk, you have to sit here. No. I'm not interested because I will tell you the reason in one moment. Normally, the cost of a bad build system or the gain of cost of a good build system is encoded into the day-to-day developer productivity. So you don't have this little display on the wall that says, hey, your build system costs you that and that that much, but you have just the salaries for your developers. But a survey changed this some years ago. The survey was going out and discovered in a very interesting way how much of your developer productivity is suffering from your build systems. They spotted four main reasons why developer productivity goes down because of a bad build system. And with a bad build system, I mean stuff like a bad written make or a bad written own build system. And they came up with, for example, bad dependencies that create failed software images. That create bad dependencies. This is very bad because this leads to this build clean culture. Because if your dependencies aren't managed very well, they are linked together in a wrong way, and this leads to wrong software or the linking errors. This is a very common problem. The next little more serious problem even is that it produces no build errors, no linking errors, but buggy software because some old binary was linked against some new library and it didn't throw an error, and therefore you ship wrong software to your customer. This is very bad, and therefore your feedback cycle goes very high because the customer comes to you back 1 or 2 weeks ago and after you changed the actual source code, and you have to find the bug then. Then slow compilation. This is what I imagine experienced everybody of you, that the software just compiles a long, long time. Who already suffered from slow compilation times? All the other guys didn't do C++, haven't you? Or just some stuff in Compile Explorer in the university or something like this. But this is a problem because it's a sneaking problem. In the first, with the first 5 files, it goes very fast. Then on the second day, it goes only a few milliseconds slower, and so on and so on. It goes up and up every day. And the next problem is, if you are 10 developers, the build time that is a problem for your employer isn't go up in 1x, but in 10x if you are 10 developers, and every developer needs 1 minute more, so you have an increase of 10 minutes for your whole team. And you have every programmer on the team, so this is the figure that matters. So we have this great excuse. I don't know if you know the comics. We are just compiling code. And maybe the naive expectation could be that the developers maybe can check some news or do something productive. But this isn't the case. They are just doing stuff. They're checking their Facebook or something like this. And even if they are able to do multiplexing, the cost of context switching is just too high. So therefore, we want a very fast build system. So last but not least, somebody have to write the CMake file, CMakeList.txt or whatever. And it isn't an easy task in every case to write them well, and you can spend much of time writing them if you don't just add your files to the your CPP files to the description files. So here's some obvious costs as well, but I think we can't get rid of this problem, but we only can reduce it because at some date we have to describe our build system. So I mentioned the survey. How much of your developer productivity suffers? And actually, they come up with a really concrete number, and it is 12%. I know it is 10%. Just a moment. But I don't want to distract you. I mean, 12% of your day-to-day developer productivity is suffering. I will do a little calculus because you are in this room very smart and well-looking, and therefore you are much better than 12%. But I just want to assume for your team 10%. So, how much value is 10% in a loss through build systems? In an old IX magazine, I read that the average programmer earns in Germany 65,000 euros, but I think it's actually more these days, especially in Munich. But let's say it's just 65,000 euro per year. Because we don't want to work too much and we have something like work-life balance, we just work 35 hours for this money. So, if you ask any accountant, he says to you, you can easily double this amount. And I asked to our accountant regarding to this, because you have to pay him material, you have to pay insurance and the workspace as well. So, you, 130,000 euro per year for a developer is quite reasonable. So, a short question to you. How many developers are in your team? Actually, who is in a development team, not a department, a team from 1 to 10 programmers? Over the half. 10 to 20? Great. More than 20? Very few. In this talk, I just will assume 10 programmers for easy calculus. So we have 130,000 per annum times 10% times 10 programmers is 130,000 euro per year. 130,000 euro per year loss. This is a complete programmer just sitting around idle. This is what your build system costs you per year regarding to the survey. So, if we take 249 workdays, because these are the workdays in 2018 in Bavaria, and take 29 days vacation, we come to 220 days workdays per year. So, your build system costs you 590 euro per year per day. Per single day, you spend for a 10 developer team 590 euro. Just imagine what you could do with nearly 600 euro per day. You can't buy just one burger, but not 100, but 600 burgers every day. Maybe you can go to a holiday, maybe some Italy holiday, and can go eating. Or you can buy a Star Wars fighter, not one, but three. Or you can just give the money to Sea-Watch and save real human lives with this geld every day. But the best is you have to decide, because within 1 week, you can buy all of this every single day. So 1 week, this, whenever you have handled the problem with your build system, maybe you can convince your boss to do this. Especially, I'm the fan of the burger stuff, you know. Great, but it isn't that easy. What is a good build system? Okay, maybe we get an appendix to Karin afterwards, because I think you're disappointed later. Build systems, as I mentioned, are very hard to do, and on the other hand, causes a significant productivity and therefore money loss. So, a good build system, mainly as everything in development, should minimize costs. I doesn't care if the syntax is nice or I'm laughing every day about the good syntax, whatever. The only and main reason is to decrease the massive costs, as we saw before. And actually, it isn't that bad. We aren't in a bad position like we are when we want to do clean code, to sell clean code to our boss. We have real numbers here. So you can measure this actually with money, and this is a good argument for your boss. So, what do C++ programmers specifically need from build system? Because until now, we are just at the state of build systems in common. The primary reason is to translate source code in executable programs. But a compiler does this as well. So there is a difference between a build system and a compiler. So what is a build system also doing? A build system translates stuff and it translates from a source to a destination. But the source don't have to be source code, and the destination don't have to be executable code. So, and it is also a build system, so there have to be many different components that are interconnected with each other. So a build system goes a step further. It don't just translate to executable, but also to documentation and stuff like this, and goes the step until the packaging for a Debian system, for example. So we aren't just at the scope of a compiler, but we have this more wide-angle view. So you see in every build system that there's one thing in common. There's no human in the loop, so we have an automated build system. It has to work with one click. And this is common in every build, in every language, and every language has some kind of a build system. The problem with C++ specifically, C++ is quite old. New languages like Rust or Go or other languages, I could do it the whole day. was designed with the build system in mind. Rust, for example, there was this project of a build system from the day one as a side project of the Rust compiler. So they already had the notion of a build system in mind. Therefore, the language and the build system are very aligned. We don't have the same in C++. In C++, the build system was added artificially from the one end, and we had make for a long time because we did it already in C. And C is C++ is not C with classes, but it started in this way. So, as I mentioned, we have many different build targets, and it's very very essential that you you fastly get the mindset of thinking in trees. We start on a version control system. Yes, this is a starting point of a build system, and we go to our products. This could be unit tests, executables, documentation, and static analysis reports, for example. We have different tree representations while we are doing this. So this could be the source tree, for example, organized in a folder structure, and this could be an object tree with dependencies in it. So keep it in mind. I will show you a very linear way, but you all you always have to keep in mind that we have multiple targets. So, especially in compiled language, we have the same pattern every time, because in dynamic language it's a little bit different. We start with a version control system. We check out the source tree. We compile an object tree, link it together, create a release package, and this is deployed to our target machine. In a development environment, the target machine is our own machine. In an, on a CI, so it's maybe a CI build system, or it's automatically deployed in a continuous delivery fashion to our servers or our clients, whatever. Autocannel to this, we have different compilation tools. So we have different tools that are supporting this, and all is running on some kind of hardware, not specified where or when exactly, but it is orthogonal to the whole. For example, we could show not only the compiled language path, but the static analysis path. Here we just have the version control system, the source tree, and from this we can directly generate a defect report with some static code analysis like CPP check, whatever. Here we have our compilation tools as well, CPP check for example, and somewhere it has to run. And maybe we can also generate some documentation. You all know it. So, I already mentioned that there are many build tools involved. Make, for example, is a build tool, not the make files it is. The build tool reads in a build description, this is the make file, and executes the build description for you. This build description describes something, for example, a build dependency graph like this. it describes that we want some compilation and some linking and some packaging here. It is a conceptual view because this compilation step don't have to take place exactly in a time with this compilation step. This compilation step could have been placed, could have been happened 2 years ago from a vendor. So this is on a vendor subtree. So we have this notions of a tree where different subtrees are owned by different people and compiled at different times. So we have basically three types of builds that every build system has to support natively, because we saw this bash script before. This bash script is Turing complete. We could do anything. This is the definition of Turing complete. But when you don't support developer build, release build, and sanity build, for example, it feels very alien to do it, and your syntax and therefore your quality will suffer. In a very short manner, what is what? Developer build is done on your machine when you just run make minus J9, or maybe you hit a green arrow on your IDE. Then the release build, what goes actually out to your customer, and the sanity build is run on a nightly basis, for example, when your CI pipeline wants to make sure that everything is okay. These are three major build types that have different requirements, and your build system has to support you with the right syntax, with the right ideas and concepts to implement them. So, I implicitly mentioned some vocabularies on the way, and now this is the conclusion on the vocabularies. I think good vocabulary is very important to discuss precisely on problems. Therefore, I want to define them. We have the build management tool. A build management tool is even beyond a build system. A CI pipeline is a build management tool. A build management tool has a one-to-many relationship to build systems. Maybe it firstly invokes all your C++ build systems, and then your JavaScript build systems, and links them together to an Electron app, maybe. Then, on the other end of this one-to-many relationship, we have the build system that is, for example, CMake, Make, Bazel, Bug, and so on. And the build system reads in a build description. This build, system, build description could be split into multiple build descriptions, but I will handle them as one. This build description will mention in some way or other, implicitly or explicitly, some build tools. One well-known build tool is the compiler. Another could be a document generator. A third could be CPP check as a static analyzer, for example. Also, the build tool performs different steps. For example, GCC, if you do the very first command I showed, has the first step of compiling and a second step of linking, at least conceptually. So we have this hierarchy of vocabularies that are very important to distinguish and very important to keep in mind that they are separated. So you can apply a divide and conquer here and can kind of think of every problem as alone. I will cover the build systems here and the build description. I will not cover much compiler stuff, and I will not cover CI stuff. I could talk hours about CI, but I mainly focus on the middle two. So here in very short CI pipeline, we see it over here. I just added it, it's orthogonal to the other, and it calls the build system on many different steps. For example, first compiling, then linking, or first create the unit test, then execute the unit test, then build the release build. This is quite normal. What is common in all modern build systems I analyzed on my way in going through the build system on this evening while drinking beer with colleagues is the dependency graph. This is the very hard notion of a build system because it's all about dependencies. And here we have an interesting parallel to architecture, to software architecture, because software architecture is all about dependency management. Here we have this dependency graph, and our build system, instead of our compiler, manages dependencies for us. Maybe this is one of the great conceptual distinctions between a compiler and a build system. Build systems make, hopefully, dependencies explicit and manage them for us. Because there is this parallel to software architecture and build systems with the dependencies, build systems can influence our architecture of our software heavily and can make it perform differently, at least in my experience. I will come to it in the Basel bug section later. I draw here just a dependency graph. For example, we have here our executable calculator. Note that the errors are flipped because these are source code dependencies. We have some dependencies on the object files. They are dependent on the header and as well as on some implementation files. But note that this nodes at the graph are heterogeneous. So we have here an executable, here we have an object file, and here we have a source file, as well as the dependency types are heterogeneous as well, and our build system have to express this. But here we have a complexity explosion, as we maybe will discover later if we have enough time. This were the basics and the concepts. The main concept you have to keep in mind is the dependency graph, because it's the common abstraction around every build system I know. And now we are basically able to create a metric, that we can apply to different build systems to choose a build system that fits our special requirement in a project. Great. I just have collected with my colleagues together some requirements we have on build systems. Most of them are so generic that they will fit at your project as well. I would bet they are all generic enough to be considered at least every decision. First of all, we want to have sub-targets and build variants. Sub-targets are just, I showed you the tree, the source tree, for example, this tree idea. You just take a sub-tree and give it to some developers. So some developers work on different sub-trees as other developers. As well as build variants, we take the same tree and create different targets out of it. So we have now three basic things I expect from a build system to provide me. I want to have the possibility of sub-targets. We can name it SO files or as shared object files in the Linux world, or DLL files in the Windows world, some kind of shared library that we can split our big project into different projects. We want to build different versions of the software, not only for unit tests and release build and sanity build, for example, but also for different platforms, for example. Especially in C++, it's quite important to have this ability and quite important that we can express this in our build system in an easy manner. This is included in the third point is included. We want to provide different target architectures in C++. Is important because we are platform specific, not like in Java where we just have the JVM. The next big thing is the learnability of the build description files. It is so important because we want to onboard new developers, and they should be able to write good build description files from day one in the best way, in the ideal case. It is because whenever you have this kind of a build expert or a build guru where you have to go, that he could extend your build file, you have this bottleneck in your development development team. Also, we touch many parts of the build description files not that often. Therefore, we have to relearn it very often. So we didn't touch it on half year, so because we just added sources, so we have to kind of relearn it. Therefore, learnability is quite important. In other languages like C++, where you work 8 hours a day with it, relearnability or learnability isn't that important. You could sacrifice it to other attributes. We have this dependency graph, and we have a very formal and closed idea, a very closed data structure. And whenever we have a very closed model, there is a possibility or a chance that we could create a declarative framework over it. Declarativeness is very, very desirable because it makes us efficient as hell. For example, take HTML. It would take a lot of code to present the same ideas or the same pages in HTML if you would do it just with drawing boxes and rectangles in an imperative way. In HTML, we can do it in a few characters. We can create an page. It is because there is this tree of objects that we can describe in a declarative way. It makes us very efficient and it's very easy to work. We never think in HTML about doing something imperative. But this works only if we have a very clear idea and very clear data structure which is very closed, that this can work. But as I mentioned, we have this with a dependency graph. Therefore, I want declarativeness in a build system. I want to declare my dependencies. I want to declare my build targets, not to create them line by line like I do it in Make, for example. On the other hand, build systems are complex, as I mentioned sometimes before, and therefore I want to have it complete. For my own feeling, it is good if I know it is Turing complete. It shouldn't be easy to create Turing complete code within a build system because we are then in this imperative world again. But at least if we think in a tree again, within one node, I want to do some imperative Turing complete stuff as well, because often there come requirements only some years later that aren't handled in a declarative model. Otherwise, you couldn't express it. Therefore, I personally want to have Turing completeness in my code. But it shouldn't be that easy, as I mentioned later. The next point is I want to have a convenience system. I want that it is easy to write the description files, just because the easier it is, the higher quality I have, because I concentrate on other stuff. As I mentioned before, I don't care about the language itself. It looks ugly. As long as it is convenient to work in. These are two different kinds of shoes. You have to keep it in mind. For me, GPL, so general purpose languages, are not very convenient to a problem because they are not domain specific enough. It could do anything in Python, but they are not tailored to a specific problem of build systems. You can argue about what convenience is. You cannot argue about what correctness is. I just need correctness in my build. This becomes a problem with when dependency management isn't working very well. So you get linked to old object files, for example, and this could create failing builds or buggy software, as I mentioned before. And this leads to this clean build culture if you lack of correctness, and the language have to support it. a next big point, especially for C++ programmers, is performance. Because if your build system suffers of performance, your turnaround times go up. This means you do some work and then hit compile, and then when you get feedback only 10 minutes after this change, your mind is somewhere else. So you aren't in your source code at this location in this moment when you get the feedback. Dynamic languages have quite difference. For example, in JavaScript, you have this auto-reloading. There is immediate feedback while you are typing. You just hit save, or not even this, and your page reloads and gives you feedback. This is what we want, and therefore we want performance. The shorter the feedback cycle, the better it is. The next thing, what is very, very hard to judge, is scalability. I had big problems to judging the different build tools about scalability. I looked at the concepts and thought, hey, could this scale or could this not scale? It is a very vague opportunity. My approach was then to look after big projects who are using the build systems and reading some blocks of them because they have some experience. For my own, I created only Hello World projects with it. You can't see scalability around teams, around projects with this. The next is, I personally need multi-language support. An average programmer should want it, because we get more and more languages. For example, we create an app for our Android phone, we need Java or Kotlin or whatever. We create it for iOS, we need Swift, and then we have JavaScript, because JavaScript is everywhere. And in an ideal world, we don't want to relearn the build tool, because every language comes with a kind of our own build tool, but an ideal build tool could cover them all. So you don't see the metric here. this could be a problem. These are basically the points I mentioned before: building sub-targets, build different editions of software, building target architecture, learnability, declarativeness, completeness, convenience, correctness, performance, scalability, and multi-language support. These are specific to my problem I had with my autonomous drones that come from my own opinion of my own past. I require of you that you think through to these points for yourself, and maybe add some, or maybe delete some, or maybe write down some of them. Great. Many blog posts, for example, many books suffer from a problem that they have only synthetic problems they cover. They are very nice to present and very nice to explain, but they aren't real world problems. Therefore, for the evaluation, I created 6 scenarios, or I took it from a book. And I applied the different build systems, build tools to these scenarios to get some kind of real-world experience. The first scenario was a source code in a single directory, like we saw in the beginning. Then source code in multiple directory, I create this source tree again. Then I switched the compilation tool, how easy it is. I created multiple variants like unit tests, release builds, sanity builds, and so on. I cleaned everything and saw if this emergency exit works of the clean build at least. And then I tried to debug incorrect builds, so I just built in failures and looked after the debugging mechanisms in the build tool, which are very, very important, especially if you have distributed builds around multiple servers. It is very important that you can even reconstruct your failing builds. So, the build tools. Just one more sip of a beer. Because no, it can become very controversial. As I mentioned in the beginning, my first attempt was to compare all build systems, what is completely unrealistic. My second approach was to classify the existing build systems in 5 categories. So I grouped, for example, Buck and Basil in 1 category. Then I applied these scenarios to each to one representative of each category and looked how well it works. I will show you the build tools I use for each category. In my opinion, the categorization went well, and I had also additional resources I will show you later. But I also will show you in a very brief manner the alternatives for each category. So my first category is low-level build systems, because I mentioned already we have multiple levels of build systems. For example, CMake is meta over make. I chose, of course, make as a low-level build systems as system, and some attempts. What I was trying there, I showed already in the beginning. Make is considered as the first build tool. Nowadays we have GNU Make as a modern version of Make, and it is still the most common build tool for C++, but these days mainly generated Make code. I made the survey already who of you is using CMake with Make, and it was nearly everyone. My advice, I have to say it now, don't use it directly. In my opinion, it's just harm. You can mess it up and you can cause some troubles that you aren't recognizing immediately, but only after a few days, or even worse, your colleagues recognize them before you and the clean build problem starts when you are in vacation, for example. GNU-Make, the idea is to do many string manipulations and variables. We saw this in my beginning example here down, where I called all this UX-specific stuff. The basic building block make are rules. Make is a rule-based build system. The rules piece together the dependency graph, as you see before. So we have this notion of the dependency graph here. And the different rules specify the nodes, the different targets in the dependency graph, all prerequisites on the input files, the shell commands, how we come from one node to another node, so one edge between two nodes, and stuff like this. And basically, the rules can describe the dependencies. A very simple make file is this. We basically do different stuff here and have different steps over here. So we lack here a little bit of declarativeness, because we have this rule or step-based approach. So to my metric, how I judged it, building sub-targets is possible, sure. Different editions of the software is possible. Different target architectures are possible. Learnability is very bad for me, alone that you have to use tabs is very unnatural. It is kind of declarative if you do it right, if you specify your rules right. Somebody else explained me how you can program declarative and make. It was basically too hard for me. The completeness is bad, because you have a very hard time to do every stuff, but it isn't very bad. So it is basically Turing complete, but with a syntax that is, for me, basically not usable. Convenience, therefore, is very bad, because nobody wants to touch make files, but of you two, you're my heroes. At least the performance and scalability are good, not very good, because it's very hard to do it right, which is necessary for performance scalability. And at least we have multi-language support. You can do anything with Make. Even I saw some Java projects you build with Make, and I have no idea why. Some guys. Naja, Okay, the alternative, of course, is Ninja. I think it's gained traction over the last years. The basic idea of Ninja is that you can't do anything. Ninja says it's don't write me, but generate me. So there isn't some stuff like string manipulation in this manner like it is done in Make. Therefore, it is incredibly fast and scales incredibly well because the processing of the Make files is very, very easy. So it's kind of an intermediate representation like an object file when you're compiling. So this is my alternative to a low-level build system. We go one level up. Who generates the Ninja files? It is, in my second category of the meta build systems, CMake, of course. Because CMake is by far the strongest build system in C++, the strongest meta build system. Some people distinguish between meta build system and build system and say, hey, you talk about build systems, these are meta build systems. In my definition, that you want to build from a target, from a source to a target, both are build systems. They are just different names. We saw already Make has this problem, and there is this obvious solution in every computer language, in every programming stuff, add a layer of indirection. So every problem in computer science can be solved through another layer of indirection, except of the problem of too many layers of indirection. Maybe. Make describes the build process on a much higher level. We have this make executable, make at executable at library, for example, and specifies the dependencies in the build graph in the dependency graph as the target link library, for example. You all know it. Meta build systems, so make, are translated into lower level stuff. This has some advantages because you are now very flexible. You can translate it to Ninja, you can translate it to Make, you can translate it to a Visual Studio project. This is a big strength of indirection. The problem of indirection, for example, if the lower level is leaking through. You already, Matthias, mentioned EMF. It's a CLIPS modeling framework. It's a meta level of models, and I personally worked a lot with it, and for me it is a perfect example that you can't prevent that the details of the layer of the layer below you leaks through. And then you have a problem because you are on a very abstract layer and you specify stuff very abstractly, but then this very concrete stuff, this very concrete failures leaking through, and there are this make errors, but you are writing CMake, for example. And this is a problem of every meta-ness in software programming. If you're doing DSLs or meta-based systems, the layer below you will leak through, and you have to keep in mind that you basically have now two build systems that you have to handle somewhere, and this decreases the learnability. So, the idea, anyway, of CMake is to generate build description files, and it's flexible because it is on a meta level. It is platform independent, which is kind of nice. It comes from the meta level because you can project from a meta level to an Unix make level or to an iOS make level, for example, when you want it. And it can express targets and connections very powerful. You have this graph through linking, as I mentioned already, and it is Turing complete because you have conditions, loops, and macros. You even can specify your own commands, but they haven't a very nice syntax. I think everybody of you saw this make files, CMake files. They are just awful. And it is because builds can become very fine-grained. And this is reflected in this CMake list. .txt very clearly, and whenever you open an open source project to evaluate it, you first check out the CMake lists, and you see it's basically impossible to understand without a big, big background, and I swear nearly nobody understands it in their own project as well as a whole system. But it is because of the weird syntax on one way and the lack of culture on the other way. And CMake, in my opinion, is a very good tool, but CMake, everybody loves to hate it. CMake is something, when you're talking together with a beer, you say, CMake is just so awful for me, and you can talk, you could talk hours. But it's your own problem, because you have written the CMake files, and you just have to do it right. It's very easily said to do it right, but it is basically possible, and you have to keep in mind that even if the syntax isn't that convenient, you should lay out your concepts like in a dependency graph and just use CMake as a tool to implement it. Great. One heuristic for you as a quick tip, maybe you all know it, just lay one CMake list file in every folder. It worked quite well for me, and it's maybe a very simplified heuristic, but at least your CMake files get splitted up. The next biggest, maybe the biggest problem with CMake is that that the documentation is very outdated because it's so old, and maybe I have no idea why nobody updates it. And there are basically no materials how to write good CMake lists. Everybody knows it after some years, but it's too late then. Yeah, sure. Because if you have a mess in your CMake lists, it's too late. You can't refactor it well, because when you do an error in your build system, build description files, your whole development team stands still because nobody can compile anymore. Therefore, you can't just do a little refactoring and few some failing unit tests. It is an all or nothing approach. Therefore, it's very hard to change them afterwards. What makes the switching of the build system very hard as well? Lots harder than the switching of a compiler, for example, where you just fix some places. So my metric: building subtag is possible. Different editions of software, different architectures possible. Sure, learnability. In my opinion, it is bad because there's very bad documentation, very bad tutorials, very outdated stuff. It's declarative on the one hand side, on the other hand side, the imperative stuff leaks through. This is a line by line stuff how you do it. Bazel or Buck does this way better. It is complete. I can create my own commands. The convenience, as soon as you are used to it, it is good. The correctness, performance, and scalability are very good for me. And multi-language support is bad, in my opinion, because I know nobody who uses it outside of C++. An alternative is AutoMake. AutoMake is part of the AutoTool suite. It has AutoConf. AutoMake is for small programs, simply understand. It wasn't, I didn't give it a big look because it isn't quite popular, I have the opinion. Then we have QMake, when you have the Qt and Qt editor, I think. For me it's a bad version of CMake. But at least this is very platform independent, because Qt is platform independent, so they had this mindset. And but both of them tools don't have many many benefits over CMake, and CMake is just the standard, the industry standard, so just use CMake. Now we come to the most interesting thing, I think, in the talk, at least for me. I mentioned already that that build system code is treated as secondary code. You don't care that much. This maybe comes that the syntax is very strange and we just are happy that it works, and when we come to a brownfield project, there is already a mess. SCANS goes an interesting way. It is basically just a Python library, and you just programming Python in it. So when you touch the SCANS files, it just feels like Python programming, and your software engineering practices immediately start to happen. You do refactoring, you have the open-close principle and the single responsibility principle and all the solid stuff. You apply it to your build files. And this is very interesting for me, and it was a very neat idea. It is relatively new, 15 years, and is basically written in Python. It is a sequence of Python method calls, and because it's Python is a GPL, a general purpose language, it is, can be very powerful. But you can create internal DSLs with general purpose language, so you can tailor a general purpose language to a specific subdomain. This is what SCANS does. So you can just call different Python functions from the framework, and so you can, in a declarative way, specify your dependency graph, and it will do the rest of you for you. SCANS builds on the idea that it does two steps. The first step is executing all builder methods as this one, and constructs a dependency graph. The second step is just to convert this dependency graph in an executable while checking all dependencies and check via MD5 sums if it can skip some steps. Sure, it is very, very easy to extend because it's Python. You can just program Python with it. And the easy to extend is, on the one hand side, the biggest advantage, as you can all imagine, but also the biggest disadvantage. I mentioned that I come from Gradle in Java, and Gradle is basically Groovy. Groovy is just a language on the JVM. This is great because you can basically do everything in Groovy, you can do everything in Python. But this leads to the fact that more and more magic happens in your build system. So very sophisticated tools start to happen, start to evolve there, and it isn't a very, very big anti-pattern that you do too much in your build system that isn't related to your build system, that isn't related directly to the dependency graph. So the fact that it is Python, you could do extended and could do anything, is the biggest advantage and the biggest disadvantage at the same time. Kind of strange. Subtargets, different editions of software, different architecture, all possible. Learnability is very big, very good. Everybody loves Python, I have the feeling. It is not declarative, it's just Python. they did their best, but the end is Python. It is complete, sure, because it's Python. It is very convenient, very correct, because it does this two-step thing very well. The performance, yeah, this MD5 stuff is nice, and they do a lot of dependency analysis, so they can outperform the fact that it is Python. Python is kind of slow. The scalability, I have no idea, because no big project I found uses SCANS. Therefore, for me, it was important that you know the concept of this kind of build system, because I had this category approach, but I don't know any big project, therefore I wouldn't recommend you to use it because you don't have an idea how it scales. And the multi-language support is very good because it's well supported. The alternative of SCANS could be out there, but I didn't found it. I could imagine that there are many libraries as build systems like use in Escons, but I didn't find much of them. And it's very dangerous to use them because they are so easy to create. If you create a new build system like CMake, you need a parser, you need an abstract syntax tree and stuff like this. You basically have to build your own compiler. Therefore, you have to bring some expertise with you and some motivation to do it right. If you do it in an imperative language as internal DSL, you just could do it in an afternoon, and then you can publish it, and somebody else downloads it and uses it and couples itself to this build system, and for me, this is very dangerous, so take it with care. So, Bazel. Bazel. This is one of the new build systems, they're really modern build systems. You could say that CMake is a modern build system, and then this is a really modern build system. We have two Bazel guys here, or three maybe. Maybe you could raise your hand. Four. They're here privately, and I already talked to them. So if you have in-depth questions, you have to go to them, because they are very nice, and they explain it very well. I will give you a short introduction. The Google has its own build tool developed since 12 years, I heard before. It's called Blaze, and they open sourced it and just created an anagram and called it Bazel. So Blaze Bazel, you see the commonality. It was first released 2015, and therefore it's very young. At least the release date is very young, but they have quite an experience within Google. Therefore, it's very matured. The goals of Bazel are regarding to the website speed through graph analysis, because they built this dependency graph in a very nice fashion, and then they are able to analyze this graph very well, and therefore Bazel is very, very fast. I tried it. It has a very, very big multi-language support. It's not just C++, but I also tried it in Java. Google open sources their project with Bazel as build system, and it feels very natural in Java as well as in JavaScript, and these are only the languages I tried. On the other hand, it feels also very natural on C++. So you declare your dependencies very well and very platform independent or very language independent, and it works for many different systems. This was a very big plus point for me. It is very scalable. Google proved it already. We don't have to talk about this. And you can create extensions. This is the way you can define a dependency. You can define that you want a binary. You give it some attributes and some sources. And I didn't do it here, but you could list some libraries as well. So it is able to build subtargets, different editions of software, and different architectures. It is very learnable because the syntax is very intuitive and very clear. After half hour, you know how to do 90% of the stuff. This is a typo. It is declarative. It is complete, convenience, correct, performs good. It scales very well, and multi-language support is the best I think I saw in the build systems. We have on this high level of declarative build systems, we have boost build. I classified it here because I didn't know it exactly. It was a very bad idea, bad approach of boost to create their own build tool. Just don't use it. Then we have Gradle. It comes from Java. It works. When you know Gradle, it works okay. But you feel in every moment that this is a Java build system and not for the JVM and not for C++. And the JVM, it is the best tool, in my opinion, because you can do anything and it's very natural because it's Groovy. And Groovy is basically Java, just a cool version of it. But in C++, the average C++ programmer hates Java and therefore hates Gradle and so stuff. Great, and then we have bug, the big competitor of Bazel in concept. It is written in by Facebook, and it encourages the creation of very small and reusable modules. And here we see the connection to software architecture. It advertises on its websites with very fast build, reproducibility, and correct incremental builds, which can be a very performance booster. And for me, the biggest selling points, as I said, are the very small modules that are linked together by default. So the language is created of the build description files to create it. Therefore, it feels very natural. And whenever it feels very natural, you just do it because it's the first way it works. So the baddest idea you can do is a custom build system. I started to implement it. I run out of time a little bit, so my advice, don't do it, so simple. If you decide to do it anyway, here's some very short and partial list of what you have to do, because there is this very, very great book, Software Build Systems. And if you keep in mind that you lose 600 euro per day, this is maybe the best investment you can make. This talk is only 1 hour of talking, and it isn't enough that you will change anything in your language, in your company. But it's also just a very, very, very tiny subset of the content which is handled here. It goes from the basics to the concepts. It creates an own kind of metric. Presents build systems not specific to C++, and many of the advanced topics if you want to create your own build system, or you just want to understand how other build systems are implemented, which is the difference from a good build system description file to a very good build system description file. So, which is for you? This is very hard. Because I don't know you. My first advice, don't use a custom one. If you are crazy enough to create a custom one, because of a reason I don't know, don't do the task by yourself, but compile to Ninja or Make. When you have to decide if you use Ninja or Make, for example, your CMake target, use Ninja because you don't have disadvantages and it's faster and it scales better. If you have very, very special builds and you have a very, very disciplined team that you don't create magic, you can give S-cons or some competitor look because it is very powerful then. But your default should be that you just use a meta build system or a declarative build system. Within this, if you have no idea and don't want to create any metric, just use a meta build system because it's an industry standard, and use CMake because it's a standard there. But if you have a greenfield project and you have enough time to integrate your CMake libraries, you can give the declarative build systems like Bazel or Buck or some other declarative build system a look. And within this category of declarative build systems, just try it. In my opinion, it is a matter of taste. So to conclude them, we have low-level build system, meta build systems, imperative, declarative, and custom ones. These are my main five categories where you have to choose. And my hope for this talk is that you go home. And when you have to decide which build system you have to take, you think on these five categories, and you create a metric to choose a category, not a specific build tool. And as soon as you have a category for your problem domain, the choice is very easier, and you can't do not so much wrong because you already in the right corner, and then it becomes much of a detail what you choose. So that's it. I think it's quite a heavy topic, and it was hard to present in such a short time, but I hope that you got some interesting insights, and if you have questions, you can ask them now. On the other hand, I will be around for some discussions which build system you prefer. Thank you very much. So any questions out there? Yes?
So why are you not using your drone project?
The question was what I'm using for my drone project. I use CMake because for me the syntax isn't that difficult, and many of my libraries already use CMake. What is the biggest selling point of CMake? Therefore, the integration is smooth, and because it's an industry standard, I finally chose this one. But I have a big love of Bazel, but I finally didn't choose it. Yes?
How do you feel about JavaScript generating CMake? Because I've seen that before.
Okay, the question was best script that generates CMake files. Then you do your CMake files wrong because you just adding another meta level is very seldomly the answer. But there's not only the approach of bash script, but there are many other frameworks that's generating CMake files. But then you have two underlying build tools under you, and they all leaking through, and it can become quite of a confusion. Any other questions? No? Ah, there. Yes, the guy behind. Okay, short survey. C++ programmers, is it bad that Bazel is written in Java? Hands up if you feel it isn't bad. It is not bad.
Has anybody actually looked at the Bazel source code to try to figure out
it was why it's doing stuff? The point was that he asked who actually looked at the code, and this is my opinion as well. It doesn't matter how it's implemented as long as it works and you don't have to check the sources.
When it doesn't, and you jump onto GitHub into the Bazel repo, I can't understand what's going on within the Java code base.
Yes, but even I'm a Java programmer, a very experienced one, and if it is such a big project as every build system, it is very hard to find out anyway what is going on. Therefore, I think it isn't a good point to say don't use the build system because it is written in a language I don't like. But maybe it was half-half, I think. Okay, any other question? I think one was there. Two? Yes? Yes, if I heard of Conan, there was this discussion on the C++ standard committee about standardizing package management, and my first plan was to integrate package management in the talk as well. Maybe we can go back. No, it's useless. Okay. Basically, it's just another dimension that plays to your build system. It's just one tool in your build system. It is maybe the most important tool after your compiler, and it's a very, very huge topic. I gave Conan a look. I gave many others a look as well, and they are very promising. And Gradle, for example, or any other build system in any other language integrates a package management tool within their build systems. C++ not, because C++ is very fine-grained. Therefore, it is externalized, and therefore it's a very huge topic on its own, which is worth a presentation for its own. Yes, and there is a lot of work done with. The question was that many people try to do package management within the build system, and a very lightweight and nice approach is to use Git submodules. Bazel has a native support for it, I think, Bazel guys. Yes. This is a very low-level approach to package management, to just paste the GitHub link in as dependency, and it will download and keep track of it for you. But the work of a normal package manager is way beyond this. You have different versions of software. You have the question if you want to manage binaries or sources as dependencies. And then you have this whole discussion around linker and compiler flags and stuff like this. So especially in C++, it's a very, very huge topic. And I, as Java programmer, had a hard time to accept that this is not part of a default build system, because I was used to Maven Central. It's a package management resource for Java. In Java, basically, if you want to use a library, it's just copy-paste works. When I started C++, this was a major disappointment that if you want to try out a library, it takes you 2 days. In Java, it takes you 2 minutes, and in Rust, for example, or Go, it takes you less than this. So this is one of the biggest lags in the standard community.
So it's simply a different approach to then using system libraries, which in some cases you have to.
Yes, this may be.
Like, I have to use the system version. It's very different than I can download something from anywhere.
Yes, and you don't have a virtual machine, for example, and you haven't a common build system normally. Okay, thank you very much, guys. Questions? I will be around here with some beer, and you can ask them to me.